Along with her having this conversation would be Masha Demidova. And Masha is a senior information security risk governance and compliance analysis. That's a tech startup by Metro, so I'm sure she'll let us know what that means. And she's also founder of the New York based collective, the Mayhem Collective, which is an unfolding experiment of artistic expression. So thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for your introduction, Mary.
Hello, everyone. So nice to have this cozy round and the microphone is over here. So I'm gonna use it.
Hello.
Yes.
Okay. So, hello, everyone, again. I am very glad to present this paper, you see here, for the second time in New York. The first time that I presented this project was at a performance center in the East Village, thanks to the invitation by Warren Neidig and the Sasfe Institute, Summer Institute of Art, which had its first iteration in New York this summer. Warren Neidig, an artist based between here and Berlin and the world, gathered us in the time frame and the theoretical frame that the Sasfe Institute of Art has been working, and that is with realism as a realist. Capitalist realism as a topic and as a departing point for the current practices that bring neuroscientists and creators and social workers to think of new languages or ways of approaching art and how the different discourses of art in different cultural contexts are possible to coexist and calm towards each other. So far, the project that is not the one that I'm representing. This is, it was a pivotal moment, just as many of the collaborations that we've been working around, and that is because this street newspaper that you have in your hands is not unusual print project. So I will start telling you what is this about. It's an octopus and it has a very polyphonic, cacophonic and kaleidoscopic form. So it's hard for me to find a straight line for you to understand what you're holding in your hands. I'll try it very quickly chronologically. So in April 2016, the artist Paul Sochacki and me launched this paper as part of an exhibition called Self-Reflection. Self-Reflection is a solo show of my curatorial task on that frame, saying I actually don't need to say anything to your paintings because they work for themselves, they speak for themselves. I would like to approach the project with a publication. Why don't we do a newspaper? A newspaper that mirrors everything your painting is addressing. And he said, well, if it's a new, it's a publication, let it be a street newspaper. A street newspaper is a format, I don't know if this is very well known in New York, but globally speaking, it's a tool for social aid for people that need
money
or effectively help. And I'm talking, well, if we do a street newspaper, let it be multilingual. And if it's only multilingual, then it has to address different ways of approaching art. But maybe not only talk about art, maybe through art approach topics that matter beyond the sphere of production and reproduction and discursive meaning. So we decided to invite several people to contribute on the first issue, and that they will already have, sorry, this is in German, so, okay. And we decided to work together with the designer Hans Löffler to design this very weird looking cover. You have three different typos of 19th century typography, building the title, Arts of the Working Class. We're referring to a pre-industrial idea of labor, post-revolution idea of labor and democracy. And at the same time, we mock the idea that in our times, there is a specific ideological frame that we can understand class struggle, since in our current governments, there are no clear orientations and privatizing interests are ruling the political sphere. So how to address all this anxiety triggering state of affairs from the perspective from the art and theoretical production, we do this. So how do we, where do we start? We have a meme that is the opener for every issue, and we have a title for a thematical frame. And the first one was, a city is a stateless mind. We wanted to have an issue that addressed to Berlin as one of these many cities that are an example of political and cultural implosion, gentrification, and economical interests that do not touch the rest of the countries, but all this growth, all this wealth goes down, deep down in the city and destroys it from very within. So a city as a stateless mind was as a kind of ambivalent idea, but also as a space without a state. So there is no national feeling if you go to Berlin, but you will have it if you go to Bochum. And it's the same if you're in New York and if you're in Alabama. So not going far to take cliches or specific examples, you get the idea. What it means to deal with migration and migratory movements. So we decided to address Berlin as this place where you can Turkish in neighborhoods and you will be understood. You talk Chinese or French and you will find communities where you can actually address problems without learning German. Yet German is, let's say, there's a very beautiful language, but the one that is ruling the art production is English. So how do we try to shift the focus or the hierarchy of languages in the cities in a productive way? And this productive way is just putting it next to each other. So we start with the editorial in German, and then just go to a column called The Death of the Left by Lori Rojas, telling how, putting in the Marxist perspective, how we cannot talk about the working class or socialism as such, not anymore in the world. Next to it, we have an advertisement by the Lula Stoschek Collection in relation to the exhibition by Arthur Jaffa in Berlin, and in a very peculiar way. So this picture you see here is actually not a work by Jaffa, but it's a photograph taken by Maine Smith, who Jaffa invited to exhibit with him in Berlin. For those, I guess everyone here knows who Arthur Jaffa is, so I won't skip that. But I gave him the opportunity, or I asked the Lula Stoschek Collection to support us with an advertisement, not to advertise her institution, but to give the space, this paid space, for the artist to decide what is the representational image to address to his own exhibition. So this is the key of our financial model. Since we give this newspaper away for a suggested donation on the streets, so street vendors sell this newspaper and we support ourselves through advertisement, very classically, as every newspaper or magazine does. But we want to stage this economical frame in a very specific way, so it has to inherently be connected to every single contribution that comes along to in every single issue. I feel my syntax is really poor, so please excuse. I'm not. My mother tongue is Spanish. This article you see here is The Street as Possibility, that was written by Alina Kolar. And next to it you have this is the second ad. We ask the biennial in the city of Munich in Germany to let us do a collage about the ideological pursuits of the artist regarding this exhibition called Public Art Munich, which was it's basically just like a performance in the city that is upcoming in November, an exhibition about art in the public space. Not necessarily public art as maybe paid by corporate institutions or the cities, but what is art in the public space as a question mark. So we put together the pictures that Alina Kolar took very poetically, but also very randomly, to her text that was really hard to edit. So the intro of this piece is, art in the street is in free circulation, really the only state in which should be in. By attending the small things, the useless and bittersweet bits and bobs of public space, we can enjoy art without the need of its production. A very complex text, if you ask me, but I thought this is the right person to hold on board to do the right mix for arts for the working class. Because Paul Sochacki and me, we come from we work in different mindsets. While I was trying to reflect on the economical frame of how this kind of projects survive nowadays, if it's not through applications for grants or the one in a million artists and residencies that get a small funding for you to produce something, really intend to this be a platform for everyone to get a profit from or like take care themselves with. Let's say every student is invited to sell it. Every creator or unemployed creator is invited to sell it. We are selling it if we're not. We don't have enough pocket money with us going to an opening show. So, how do we let it grow? And this is thanks to this concept of new advertisement and new kind of advertorial. And Paul would go around and think of Mohamed Salemi, for instance, or Alina, like thinking of new forms of ideological proposals and in very close relation to what the art experience should be. A very personal, but also a very a formal aesthetical experience. If someone is not agreeing with what I'm saying, everyone is free to comment and raise questions if my formulations are getting a bit weird. But Alina was exactly the person that we thought should be part of this. I will come to the development of our editorial group after I just pass through this. So this all advertisements are made also by artists, also referring to a certain idea or a certain experience of precariousness, and at the same time having commentary, for example, like from Mohamed Salemi or William Kerbeck about the course of ideological shifts, for example, in England with Brexit, having the European Alternative as an organization that helps activists and small parties around Europe to get a trans-European role to play in the European Parliament, as well as having institutions play with this this spreads that we offered, saying, well, this work by Jose Maria Talker will fit here next to our advertisement about art and politics. We curate this, and we curate this ads, and we curate the contributions the way we know how people work. So how people work, it's a complex. It's a complex thing, but at the same time, we try to go and ask museums, do you have enough space or enough access to disabled people? How do you control the prices, the value of your tickets? Do people have enough money to pay a regular ticket, or who are the ones that can have a reduced price? So Stefan Dillenmuth, an artist based in Munich, was also a professor at the art school, decided to put as a title of his exhibition the red price of the entrance itself, while Christoph said, one of our first contributors, contributors, talks about access and restrictions in Tehran in an open letter. Sonia Boyce was one of the first persons that we had a conversation with for the newspapers. We tried to, even though this is, as you may see, also a constant explosion of the canons and the parameters of journalistic formats, we try also to have a connection to what we understand or what resembles journalistic codes, like a basis where at the end of the day we are also informing everyone about current conflicts about either gender equality, payment equality, and so We do not publish reviews on our print, but we try to connect society and art exhibitions differently. So that is how, for example, Kolar, who is a very well-known critic in Germany and also my partner, decided to give a twist on this, on the, exactly the same thought and reflection, defining art institutions and public collections as the banks of the people. So we should actually see museums as the house of a currency, of a value that we can all have access to and use it for our own empowerment. Next to this, our article, we invited the Volksbühne to give us tickets for the people that cannot afford to go to the theater. And we decided to choose also the play in which we would like to offer an entrance to maybe a complex play, but a play in which exactly the same terms are being handled. So this is how we've been, this is how we started. Text in German, text in Spanish, text in Chinese, or a commentary on how in South Asia artists collective are being built and told. We didn't know where to go with this. It was just the first paper, and we decided, why don't we just try to see if someone is interested in a company or a foundation that is already helping homeless people to get out of this very complex state, to also get a connection to what our production is, or this reflection on precariousness in this world. How do we see this happening? If this cannot be connected, if this can be connected to bigger institutions, and these institutions are already doing this. So we started calling all their street newspapers. Nobody seemed interested. Art, contemporary art, and art discourse and homelessness. How is this supposed to be together? So, well, we think everybody wants to have the chance to have an opinion, no matter what the topic is. It's cultural, political, and social. Everybody kept their doors closed, so we decided to keep on doing this ourselves. And the second issue, the third issue, the fourth issue, the fifth issue was always in conjunction to either an exhibition, a biennial, or an art fair for independent spaces. That would allow us to present the paper in a different city, and that while parallel in Berlin, to have the chance to be both in the arts field, where we are departing from, and constantly getting new in German, the word, I love the word in German, so that's what I'm saying. I will say this Mitstreiter, the ones who are having a conversation with, to get along the way, and not only in terms of growth, but also in terms of access and usage, how this newspaper can be taken to other parts of the world. So it may sound very ambitious, but it's pars pro toto, where we can put all seeds, the seeds that we want everybody to make use of. This is how we ended up in Palermo. This is how we ended up in London. I'll jump to the third issue. And in the third issue, we had the chance to work with another street newspaper that coincidentally is also made by an artist called Kieron Silverstone, who produces the street newspaper in for London called the Nerve Meter. The Nerve Meter is produced annually by Kieran, and Kieran said, why don't we just work together and we distribute Arts of the Working Class when the Nerve Meter is out of stock. So this is the third issue. We produced it for London. London is, after Berlin, the second city that distributes the newspaper with more consistency than others. After London, it comes Vienna and other cities in Germany, as well as, soon in LA, depending on the kind of collaborations that that are open to us. The question, how to produce a street newspaper for a city or for the world, was clearly not answered until the third issue, although we had the chance to interview a group like the pop band Live Act, or have a poster by an artist like Oscar Murillo. We decided that this is not happening if we don't have associate editors. I'll jump here from the third to the fifth issue. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to interrupt me. With the fifth issue, we started this new year. So the first year we had four issues in different cities with different collaborators. For the fifth issue, we decided that we need to have a relationship to local issues, local conversations, and at the same time be connected to our departing point. It's not only Berlin, but it's also the social frame that allowed us to start this project as it is. I don't think it would be the same if we would have started Arts of the Working Class in a city like Munich or Antwerp, where the people passing by or the languages being spoken, the currencies that are being handled are not available for as much as people as possible. So Berlin is the perfect city for this. But we needed to start do some amendments to the format. So we decided to start with associate editors. We start to think for years, and every year we will have a group of people. So far, every associate editor has stayed with us. And we have accomplished perhaps the achievements that we wanted. So in the first in this first attempt, it was to start with Babisha Tankia, Menashe Tirukodu. Babisha is in the current issue, in the latest one. But Babisha, Menashe Tirukodu in New Delhi and Nick Copenhagen in Berlin will both stretch this band in the range of ambivalences and contrasts that we wanted to see in the paper. Coincidentally, the artist and poet Alina died in the same month, in January of this year, that we were thinking of what could be the topic that we can stretch between a city like New Delhi and Berlin, and that is the body. The body as an alien as the world. And this is also a verse from a poem by Alina, which we also presented here. Every cover has a meme and a poem and selection of the articles we present. We try to always have the different languages also presented on the cover. So the body. But the body, it may be in cyberspace, and the body in the cities. Just to take an example, the Museum for Contemporary Art in Leipzig gave us the chance to work with one of the current artists to decide what to bring, and she did a collage of the let's say the most used words and terms towards gender equality. Next to it, we would get an article by Sara Khan, who's an author known for her ghost stories and creepy stories, but in a very simple and a very clear language. So she would do a column based on Berlin, while we would go with the meta haven to other spheres like jokes, memes, or have an interview with a rapper like Amine, who is also risking and having new ways of using language, genderless but also a gender fair language in rap, having a conversation with him and Kolar. As well as inviting artists for the first time to illustrate the articles. So the illustrations will be a kind of another layer on this kind of collaboration. So we talk to the authors, we tell them who are the ones who are gonna illustrate our newspaper, and we tell the artists to do a selection towards the topics we are already dealing with the authors on the run. So it's a process that goes parallel, but also nuances of thinking that also the pursuit of get a connection in between without the need of illustrating being too, let's say, flat in this kind of relationships. Our galleries like Contemporary Art and Fine Arts also have been very open to this, and instead of making an advertisement on their current show, they would suggest to ask Sara Lucas to give something that is related to not only to the work of the gallery, what they represent, but also what we are representing within the newspaper. We also ask art students or the students that we encounter in different art schools to be part of our contributions. And this is a spread that I'm really proud of to show to you, because Kimberly Bradley, who is the contributor of the magazine, lifestyle magazine Monocle, and the newspaper of your city here, in New York Times, is having an article based on the travel she made to China and the Chinese New Year. And next to her, we have Anna Schmidt, who is one of the students we met in Vienna. During the past year, 1.5 years, we've been invited constantly to go to different art schools to talk about new ways of printing. And while we were defining the shape of this, or the life, the soul of this newspaper, which has been very, not only a great retribution, but at the same time a good school, because we can also learn from the students, and we want to give them the same space as we are all part of, we believe we are all part of the same production process. So, Tobias Celoni, next to the Folklore, this shop in Madrid, the first shop that wanted to distribute our newspaper before we created that directory was also placed next to him. So this is a very casual picture in front of the store, and next to it, the artwork by Tsunomi. This is how it's been operating, and this is how we get to the current issue that you're having on your lap, to which I would like to jump over for you to have an idea of the language we foster within our newspaper. Oh, it's on here. Let's start with issue 7. Issue 7 is coincidentally currently at the new MoMA building and the People's Studio, which was a great surprise for me to see. There is a bookshop called Wendy's Subway that maybe you may know, that saw the paper at Printed Matter and decided to put it as a selection of the publications that are referring to collective imagination in a new space of the MoMA that it's devoted to a better understanding. And I'm making an advertisement here for the for the museum that is about to open, but that you know better than I do, to this new definition of a museum as a public space, but also a place of art understanding. I'm really proud to see the paper there, and this wouldn't have been accomplished if this kind of collaborations that I tried to draft you wouldn't happen, and these are like purely spontaneous constellations. And to this belongs Masha. To this kind of constellations belongs Masha Demidova, who spoke to us on an Instagram message, telling us the story and how she came towards the newspaper and how she sees the potentiality not only for her to be involved in this network, this web of people working towards better labor conditions and new art discourses, but also in ways of helping each other. And that's why I would like to make a shortcut here, and before giving the microphone to Masha, with whom we would like to read some of the fragments of the issues so far, how I see in her the way of a non-hierarchical and collaborative forum of belonging and working together can work. So I'm very happy that she's sharing with me the stage. Masha.
Hello. Hello everyone. My name is Masha. So first I'd like to just share how we met, how I met Maria, how I came across this paper. So I was in Berlin a couple months ago, and I was in a coffee shop, and you know, I was trying to find something to read. I found the paper, I fell in love with it. I mean, immediately, like, first article, romantically involved. So I asked the coffee shop owner where I can buy this paper. They said, oh, you know, a guy comes by. A guy? What does it mean? Well, you know, he sells the paper. I'm like, okay, so a street vendor. Get later, I got to learn about this culture of homeless people selling the paper, and this is what Maria was referring to. So in Berlin, homeless people can pick up paper at a pickup station, and then keep the profits to themselves, right? And it is not
like
a percentage.
Like 80%?
100%.
100%? I know, 80%.
So it, with this particular paper, it would be 100%, right?
Anyway,
this,
anyways, it's benefits to the homeless.
Okay. not something that I've seen here in New York. So having said that, I spent 3 days trying to chase this person around Berlin, trying to find the paper. Wasn't able to. On my last day in Berlin, I went to visit a friend of mine, and as I was approaching the gate of the building, I saw art of the working class in my peripheral vision, and it was their office. It was late at night, like art of the working class. And then I look on the ground, and there's a cabinet filled with papers. I was like, oh my god, holy grail, there you go. I was chasing this paper for 3 days around Berlin. So I thought it was a funny story, which I shared via Instagram with them. I was like, hey, hey, just funny anecdote. I just fell in love, blah, 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 blah. They get back to me and they say, oh, interesting. Would you like to have an introductory phone call via Skype? Sure. We have a phone call. 2 weeks later, I'm representing Arts of the Working Class at the Printed Meadow, New York. Right, my first art book fair ever. Never even dreamed about being there as a vendor. Fabulous. Also, somewhere in my notes, because I am planning to move to Berlin, I have a note saying check out the Goethe Institute of New York. Well, guess what? I meet Catherine, who is here today. Because Art of the Working Class work with the Goethe Institute. And I also meet the executive director of the Goethe Institute, right? And it's all done via this sort of me falling in love with the paper and not being afraid to reach out to them. And yeah.
What else was I supposed to do?
I would like to start the reads, but Masha, it's really a pleasure to see how a field can evolve, and I remember calling and it's like, how much did you make a printed matter? And we're like, I don't know, maybe like $100, and like, please keep them for yourself. It's like, no, it's for you. It's like, no, everybody should take, there's a kind of retribution from which we can all take a profit from, and take the newspaper as where you want to take it. And that's it might sound so like a romantic idea, like a utopian idea of collaboration, but it actually is. And we try to be fair on the interest of everyone around the world. So we have this Instagram account that, well, you can also actually visit it yourself, but we have requests of people in Santiago de Chile or in Los Angeles or in Switzerland saying where can I buy it, or after we say, well, please follow this link, we can send you something, or you can find it on the streets, or you can find it during this event. Sometimes there's people that, and how can I get involved? And this feeling that we have accomplished a certain atmosphere in which everyone feels invited to be part of, it's somehow more rewarding than the idea of having a congruent thematical thing for itself to be only an informative medium. So this is something that it's been developed so far, and first we took Alina on board a year ago, and then Kieran came along and he's now the distributor in London, and then Henriette Gallus in Graz came and say, why don't you are part of this Spanish Herbs Festival, and through this festival, knowing our distributor in Vienna, and taking it from her side, like, I want to distribute this, I want to be part of this, like, please help yourself. Or this is also how we also knock the door, so knocking doors at Georg Bloch's address at the Goethe Institute, knowing that maybe this is not something that's too unusual this is something that's hard to support, I guess. Well, like taking it from the experience that we got from other street newspapers, but also having someone say like, you can just put the newspaper here and convert it into a pickup station for the ones that want to sell it. And this is how also we arrived at Residency Unlimited, thanks to Natalie Youngless, who was at the event in May in the Performance Center, but also because there is another collective called Heckler, run by Josh Nidotinsky, who was the very first one to be on the door of the Goethe Institute and saying, where are the newspapers? I want to take them to Philadelphia. So where in Philadelphia is being now distributed.
May I ask something?
Yes, please.
So I would like actually to hear more about the labor conditions that you're saying, so more explicitly, and also through the every issue of the, because I mean, Art of the Working Class is a fantastic title, so I do understand in terms of discourse. I mean, I just encountered a full newspaper for the first time, so I cannot tell from the context. But I mean, I kind of see in terms of discourse how you are dealing with it, but is there like a type of research in terms of what could be this working class? And I mean, because I think it's part of what you're saying, that people do want to get involved with it. There is a certain thing in this creating of a working class that
we try to have an encounter every time. So it's if there is a submission via email, we say, why don't we meet? Let's meet. We want to know who you are and why you want to. Why is the idea of a new idea of labor so important to you? Or why is the inquiry of if the question of is there an art form, is an art definition that belongs to everyone, if the working class is the majority, it's the mass, and if the working class as a Marxist definition of the individual that has only his labor to have the right to exist, and that's so many different layers of society that you're experiencing now, your body, your exhausted body, your anxious body, how do we come together? So there is, for example, Julia Velosova, who is an art advisor, and she just came to Berlin to start art history, comes from a wealthy family, and she comes to me and says, I'm exhausted, I don't make my own money, I'm exhausted of working for this laugh, you know, and I do feel that people are treating me unfairly, and I just don't know how to express that that kind of oppression that I feel on this level, where I may have all these accesses, all these dinners, and all these people, and not really know which my place here is. It's for me as or as for Paul and Alina, a clear case of conflict in which, as the ideological and social conflict that we are experiencing daily, and Julia has exactly the same right to be part of the paper, as well as Gabriela Valareso, who has a publishing house in Quito that has to work 24/7 in a graphic design studio for someone else, in order to make her publishing house be somewhere in the map of publishing organizations. Gabriela is, by the way, one of the heads of Terminal Ediciones, who were the ones who invited me to put the paper on their table in printed matter, to which Masha was also helping us out. And this kind of exchanges are crucial for us, because of course the long process of belonging and being given access to it's it's not easy, and the currencies are different. So maybe, I don't know, X person who runs this fair, but and maybe Terminal is just too small for the art fair, the art book fair in Berlin, but I can share my table with them. And after that, these kind of exercises are so crucial. But in terms of the content, we try to not say, okay, do you you're interested in having these kind of exchanges or producing content this way. It's about what exactly do you want to say. And we will take all of our time to go through it until it has the right tone, it has the clarity that it's needed, and the space that it's needed to have the poetic air that it needs. We have currently also other kind of submissions, for example, the curators of the Berlin Biennial for Latin American curators coming from the South, which are Lizeche Laniado, curator from Sao Paulo, who was also in charge of Sao Paulo Biennale, or Renata Cerveto from Buenos Aires, Maria Bernal and Agustin Perez Rubio from Chile, who, looking at the landscape of publications in Berlin, decided to contact us and say, we want to write in Spanish and we want to have a column on your paper. And this is the way we would like to appear in the city with our language and for the people that maybe are not addressed in these other magazines. So this is a very peculiar collaboration that we have, and one of the few examples there of things that are to come. Thanks of a very pure interest. If we can work from pure interest on, the most crazy things can happen. For example, Jacobin magazine had an article called Abolish the Billionaire Class. I haven't read a bold article as such in German language. So we asked for a translation, and this is one of the few translations that we do, is saying, okay, in which kind of shifts can we make so the article, the depths of every article that can be published in bigger magazines can also be also zoomed out. I've got really good conversations around this article, the extra blood. I wanted to show you something before I could really finally read something. I don't know, with how many languages do you speak here in Iran? How many languages are here beyond English? Spanish, German,
Hebrew.
We don't have Hebrew yet. Not
but
yet. But Russian. Yeah, it's on the cover. It's on the cover.
No, it's the and here.
Yes. One other thing I want to show you is the extra blood. So we literally have really little money, and we try to break it even. So from the standard of paying 100 euros for a contribution, that is what most of the art magazines pay. We try to pay everyone for an article. No one has to publish for free, even submissions. We offer, this is what we can offer, and we try to stick to that until in the near future we can. This is not only wishful thinking, this is also a programmatic, systematic attempt, is once we can finally have the a stable frame, financial frame, that we have to make a distribution wave so everyone can get something back if we are able to pay so far we tried to break even, and one of the things that we've improved this year is to have an extra blood, which is an advertorial. Advertorial is a very pejorative word that many people, many journalists hate, many authors hate, because they feel obliged to write about something nicely that they maybe do not believe in. But we try to give ourselves the freedom to choose about which kind of things we would like to talk, and which is the core of the magazine, of the street newspaper, in conjunction with other institutions. So the extra blad is the supplement you will find inside every newspaper, every issue from this year on, that is paid content. This paid content is actually always made in disputes and conversations. There are huge arguments, and there are huge ways of challenge the standards, expectations of institutions. This one, the first one you can see here, is for the year's program of Savvy Contemporary, the Laboratory of Ideas. This is called like this, in Berlin, who have a really interesting way of working. So the curatorial and the, let's say, the bodily work, they belong together. Everything is formulated in the community. The community that builds Savvy Contemporary, because 10 years long, they have no means to pay their workers. They do now, but it was a way of saying, okay, the authorship or the representational character, the role of every position in this institution, this is given to everyone that is involved, no matter if they are apprentices, volunteers, or if it's the director of the institution, who is Bonaventura di Kung, who created seven curators of the Documenta 2 years ago. After this extra blad, we had the chance to work with SASFE, Summer Institute of Art, to work with the Angewandte, that's the University of Art and Applied Arts in Vienna, and currently we're working with the NS National Socialist Documentation Center in Munich, and talking about memory and the cultivation of memory and the stand of against fascism and these new forms of radical conservatism in the countries of the world, and specific with the historical heritage of Germany. Questions so far? Other questions? Well, I'm happy to see also familiar faces around. This is Elmer Meller, who is an artist currently based in New York, who was one of the people that hold us to other cities, and that was at the beginning of the year in Stuttgart, and one of the places that he runs called Palermo. And this is also where we shot the fifth issue. And this issue, we had the... yes, I think so. Yeah. About ways of collaborating, and because we are at Residency Unlimited.
Yes. I have a question. I love holding a magazine in my hand and a paper reader and a book reader, but I was just wondering if you do an online version as well. Would you consider that?
Yes. Yes. It actually takes a while, because it took a while, and it's being launched at the end of this month. It's a soft launch. But since the newspaper is so complex and so ambivalent in itself and so special, and it's hardly graspable, and at the same time it's so there, we wanted to have a website that resembles exactly the same feeling. And it's so hard to make exactly the same. It's just like, oh, let's just put the content there. It's being the month of parallel development, and since we are a very small group taking care of all this very long process that we actually want to take care of, conversations, the meetings again, and being here and just presenting the newspaper one and twice and three times a month. You will see that it's going to be really, really nice. It's mm-hmm. called artsoftheworkingclass.org. Stay tuned. Since we're at Residence Unlimited, and I really like the fact that this is a place that it's taking care of, the care for artists, care for communities, care for the frame in which people can safely work. I would like to give Masha the mic to read, and maybe this is the way we finish the presentation with the end of artists. The end of artists is a contribution, this fourth contribution by Mohamed Salemi, who is a very feverish critic of the entire identity politics movement, and trying to give a fair vision of what the roles in the definition of art is going to be. So, the definition of artist, what is that today? And within this space, I'm really happy to read it out loud. And if you're interested in the papers, you can just take it. There's a suggested donation, and you're free to give out something for it, or you are also invited as a free to take more copies and share with, sell it yourself, or share it with your friends.
I also want to say that it's pretty fascinating what Maria and only two other people were able to achieve. So it's only three of them, and of course, you know, their collaborations with other people. But the structure of the magazine was built and envisioned by three people. So it's pretty fascinating. And just to add to what Maria said, this is our first public interaction. We met, like 3 days ago in person. So again, thank you so much for providing me with an opportunity to participate. And I think I'm just going to echo Maria's message. Once you read this paper, you will see why I have been having a romantic affair with it. The language is just beautiful, and as someone who also, English is not my first language, as you will see from my arising accent as I read through this article. But the paper is so open to collaboration, especially for artists or anyone really who is interested. And I'm an example of that.
Cool.
Am I done? Just reading a bit?
Yeah.
How much of you feel in front of you?
Yes. So I would like to actually read my favorite bits. I should mention that the reason this particular article spoke to me is I am exploring a collaboration between data privacy and artists and social platforms, and what does it all mean? So this particular issue spoke to me in that sense. It's page 19 of the
eighth issue,
page 19, the article called The End of Artists. We have nobody to blame for this but ourselves. That's right, The End of Artists is a kind of suicide, but through mass replication rather than cleansing or annihilation by external forces. Artists will disappear like how zombies eat each other in movies. Isn't that fabulous? I'm skipping forward a bit to my next favorite part. The history of artists' disappearance goes like this. After scarcity, let's say in the 1950s, when there were only a handful of professional artists in each community and everybody knew each other. In Canada, where I'm from, around the time when the Canada Council for the Arts was established, the late 60s and the early 70s, there were more resources for arts than actual artists. Agencies like Canada Council would advertise in art papers to let artists know that they can provide every applicant with project funding. Slowly but surely, the social policymakers began to think that universities and colleges needed more art programs. Still, in the early 90s, receiving a Master's of Fine Arts, MFA, was not a common phenomenon. But by the end of the 90s, serious and ambitious artists with a Bachelor of Arts knew that studying for an MFA would increase their chance of having a career. The 2000s were all about the natural technological shortening of the art hype cycle, or what it took for a young artist or a new style to make it from graduation shows to commercial galleries, art fairs, and biennials. The decade also witnessed the mushrooming of PhD practices and curatorial programs at universities and colleges. In addition to tenured faculty, these newly expanded art education programs were increasingly staffed by famous but precarious easy. Wait a second, let me go back. Staffed by famous but precarious easy jet setting curators and artists flying around the world to give workshops, seminars, and to advise departments and graduate students. By this time, career making in art was a group effort and involved more than just a gallerist with a hefty Rolodex in Chelsea like Tony Schaffrazi, or a single powerful curator at the Guggenheim like Nancy Shapiro. Curators and dealers were now only two nodes in the rhizomatic network of stakeholders that also included art press, art academia, art museums, art residences, art prizes, art biennials, and art collectors. To have a career as an artist, one had to have the support of at least half of these forces, but also each of the centers of art power had their own artists to introduce to the system and promote. Together, these factors lead to an oversupply problem in the field. For those who diagnose the disappearance of artists as part of a critique of capitalism, the death of artists began when Art Basel launched a Miami edition in 2002 and collecting contemporary art became a new status symbol for rich Americans with easy access to cheaply borrowed money. And since the dealers knew exactly what their budgets were, all of a sudden, newly graduated artists from, you name it, MFA programs began making paintings and sculptures for around $50,000. Entire gallery systems were quickly set up around art fair schedules, and the growing art education industry worked in tandem to feed fresh blood into this infrastructure. If Warhol glamorized the art world by introducing pop singers, celebrities, fashion models, and designers to the field, the new art economy completed the circle by providing it with a stable supply of income extracted out of all sorts of places, but also the minority homeowners who were taking out those high-yield risky loans to fulfill their suburban American dream of a big family house. Then came the mortgage crisis and the subsequent economic meltdown. Suddenly, the 20 to 50K range market was deserted, and those investors, what a nice way of describing assholes who buy our government and control our money and wealth supplies, who had supposedly lost everything, but were about to receive most of it back through the Bush Obama they allows. We're from now on only interested in blue chip artists as safe investment. One thinks that the economic shockwave of 2008 would have caused art education to follow a corrective course like that of the art market, but no way. Art programs continue to grow, maybe even faster than before 2008, with many universities offering PhD practice and upgrading their MA in cultural studies to PhDs. Perhaps the rationale for this counterintuitive tendency amongst art education administrators was that when the economy is hit with a recession, young people unable to find employment tend to return to school. Meanwhile, as artists proliferated professionally, the number of galleries and institutions where their work would be exhibited and the number of collectors who would buy their work kept shrinking. The light at the end of the tunnel got smaller and dimmer by the hour. Let us not forget our increasing capabilities of digital tools, especially mobile phone coupled with platforms like Facebook and Instagram, helped to balloon the number of artists, or at least those who thought that by increasing the number of followers and likes on social media, they can claim to belong to the category. Interestingly, right around the time when the small and medium-sized galleries started to close down one after another, suddenly everybody was an artist. These capabilities also helped professional artists to double and triple their social participation, in a way inflating their existence in general by adding their virtual to their actual reality. The last gig that finally pushed artistry into its historic grave was the growth of information about art. Everywhere people looked, they saw announcements about exhibitions, biennials, art fairs, conferences, symposiums, workshops, and summer schools, all appearing in one's mailbox or on social media walls, compounded by repeated shares and forwarding. People received so many invitations to events that on the actual day of an event, they couldn't even find which one they had planned to attend. Art was finally, fully industrialized like pop culture, as Adorno wrote in his grave.
Thank you so much for coming today. Any requests, any ideas, or any complaints are pleased to be addressed here. If not now, then afterwards. There are some snacks.
Yeah,
thanks to Natalie and Liz and Mary Ellen for making this happening today.
Thank you for being here. It's not finished, I hope. Maybe standing up if you feel like it, you know, just feel welcome. And thanks so much. And we will make sure to distribute the magazines and suggest a donation that we will then let you know for your next trip to New York when Masha, you know, so we can discuss how you proceed in that way.
Yes. I mean, it was mentioned that the Goethe Institute had this 1,000 copies.
Less.
Now we have, or less, that we would like to find a pickup station or a home for. And I'm really happy that
here.
Residency Unlimited.
And then we can just talk about how, you know, how we do the kind
the
of transaction.
Yeah, so it's a great
day.
One of the first
yeah,
refuge against this despairing platforms in which the definition of artist is being manipulated. This is one of the aisles of refuge that the city has.
We're in a church.
Thank you for having us.